Yeah, I want to say a big welcome to this lovely day. I don't know about you, I just realized that today is 25th, so like almost 2 months is gone, boom. You know, it's picking up an hour like that. But we thank God we're still alive, and we're here. I want to welcome everyone who is at the service this morning. And if there's anyone here for the first time, I can see. We're just continuing our book, in our study of the book of John that we've been looking at for a few weeks now. And today we're looking at the Good Shepherd. And just to give a preamble to that, I just want to read Psalm 23. Probably the most popular psalm, you know, that, you know, we know. It says, "The Lord is my shepherd, I lack nothing. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He refreshes my soul. He guides me along the right path for his name's sake." And Psalm 79:13 says, "Then we, your people, the sheep of your pasture, will praise you forever from generation to generation. We'll proclaim your praise." And that's what we want to do today, because we know we have him as our shepherd. Because we know that he leads us, you know, to lie down in green pastures, not famished ones. Because the sheep don't like, you know, brown looking things, they want the green ones. As a sheep of his shepherd, as a sheep in his fold. It gives us assurance that he is leading us. He is a good shepherd. I'm going to look at that. So, can we just bow our heads in prayers? Father, we thank you because you are a faithful God. We thank you because you are the good shepherd, the very shepherd of our souls. We thank you, God, because of your goodness. We thank you for your mercies. We thank you for your everlasting love towards us, that you lead us, you know, to green pastures. You lead us beside the still waters, not troubled waters. We thank you because we have this assurance in us that by with you on our side, we can face any challenge that comes across our way. But even as we come together today as an instruction to your word that says we should not despise the coming together of your people. Lord, we have come together to worship you, to adore you. And we say, oh Lord, whatever burden may be in our hearts, as we lay it at your feet, we ask, oh God, that give us the garment of praise, to worship you, to praise you, to adore you. All this we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to take two quick songs together. The first one says, "Bless the Lord, O my soul." And just basically, it's about 10,000 reasons why, you know, we can praise God. And the second one followed by saying that, "Come, people of the risen King." And we trust God that this will minister to us as we sing the songs.
Worship his holy name. was near and my time has come. Still my soul will sing your praise unending. 10,000 years and then forevermore. Bless the Lord.
may be seated. Just want two or three people just to pray, just say something to the Lord. One of the verses in that song, the second song, says, come people who have testimony to share, and for those who are still involved in the fight. So perhaps yours is not through yet, or maybe you're struggling with something. Just open your mouth in the presence of your Father, and just let us, two or three people, just say a word, please.
Thank you that in this life, even though we would have trouble and tribulation, as it were, we have this comfort, Lord, that you have overcome the world. And Lord, we can rest in the fact that even though we have these battles and these fights, and those difficulties are not removed from us, but we know this, that you are with us in the fight, and you are with us in those battles. You don't take them away, but you are there in the fire with us, Lord. Mm-hmm. Like you were with the three in the furnace, and there was a fourth figure, one like the Son of Man. We know, Jesus, that you are with us in our battles. And I thank you, Lord, that we know that the war has been won on the cross. Mm-hmm. And we live in the good of your victory on the cross. So I thank you for battles won in the past, for battles that you will be with us in the future, and the battles we are in now, we say, Lord, we trust you. In God we trust. We believe that you are working all things together for our good and for the glory of your name, Jesus. You are never absent, not for a moment, you're never absent from our lives. For you promised, I will never leave you nor forsake you. I will be with you forever. I think that that's a promise for each and every one of us who put our trust in you. So thank you, God. You are the God of all comfort. You are the God of all hope. And in you we trust. Thank you, Jesus.
Father, we just want to say a big thank you to you. Because this verse came to mind that even though we walk through the shadow of death, we will fear no evil. For there to be a shadow, there is a light somewhere. And something is just blocking that light, creating that shadow. And Lord, because we know you are the source of light. You are that light. We ask, O God, that everything that is blocking the light from reaching us and creating a shadow and creating a fear in our minds, we pray, O God, that by the risen of the risen Lord, we command them to disappear. And Lord, so that the light can shine on our situations, we can get insight into what you want us to do, clarity of vision, O God. Blessed be your name, O God. In Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to take this next song. As we take this song, at the end of the song, the kids can go to their Sunday school. It talks about, here is love, vast as the ocean. Can we stand up, please?
Show each one of us how it applies to us, Lord, that we would understand it fully and what it means. In Jesus' name, amen. You know, for the last few months, we've been going through the book of John. And the slide here says, discovering who Jesus is and the difference he makes. And this is one of these passages that we need to see the difference he makes and why who he is matters so much. Because the world tries to put different labels on Jesus all the time, but what we need to think about is what he says about himself. Because if we take the world's different perspectives, the world sometimes says, some people say, well, I don't even think he existed. Well, historians and archaeologists don't really debate that. It's not even the thing that they worry about. Other people say, well, he was a good teacher. Well, he can only be a good teacher if what he was teaching was true. You can't be a good teacher and be lying about who you are. It doesn't work that way. It doesn't go together. There's not too many people that if we saw them going through their daily life and they lied about everything, that the society would look at him and say, that's a good person. Because what you say about yourself matters, and what he is going to declare in this passage is very, very important. Today we're going to be looking at John chapter 10. So if you have your Bibles or your apps, that's where we're going to be at. And as we go through, I know we normally have the scripture reading before, but I'm going to go through it as we do the preach and everything. But one of the things that we see in this passage is there's a lot of talk about sheep and shepherds. And if you look through the Bible, there's a lot of referring to sheep and shepherds. In the context of the Bible, we're the sheep. And I don't know if you guys realize this, but that could be a little bit insulting. And the reason for that is, if you've ever been around sheep, you figure out real quick, they're not too bright. We were talking with the guys last week, we were at Paul's house doing the men's study, and we were talking about the whole thing about being sheep, and this video came to mind that I had seen where you had this guy, I don't know if he was a shepherd or just someone trying to help him, this sheep is stuck in this ditch head first, and they're trying so hard to pull it out, they finally get it out, and what does the sheep do? He starts running, bounces twice, and then literally head dives straight back into the ditch and sticks himself in. But if you think about that, see, some of us are snickering and laughing, but if you think about that, we do that sometimes, don't we? God shows us what we should do in a situation, and we're like, nope, bing, bing, straight back in. And it happens all the time. But what we see here, like in this picture, you have this shepherd who is leading the flock. The shepherd has various different jobs as being a shepherd. It's not just you're out there with the sheep. No, you're protecting them. You're guiding them. You're keeping them together. If one goes astray, you go and get it. You bring it back. A bad shepherd is going to become very obvious because he'll be the one wandering through a field by himself with a stick, thinking there's people following him when there's no one there. And as we're going to look at in this passage, we'll see that Jesus is not just any shepherd. He's the good shepherd. In this passage, he's going to talk about the sheepfold. And this is an old sheepfold up in Scotland. And basically what you see is there's that one main gap, which is supposed to be there. The rest of it's kind of fallen down a bit. But what the shepherds would do is they would not just put their flocks. Sometimes multiple shepherds will put their flocks into these sheepfolds. And if you notice, there's no door because the shepherds literally will act as the door. One of them will take a turn and they will literally put themselves in that gap to protect the sheep from anyone coming in or any animal coming in to prey on the flock. I realize if we don't talk about it in this way, I mean, let's face it, we haven't run into too many sheep this week, have we? But if we were out in the countryside, in more rural areas, this might be more understood by us. But since we're not, it helps us get this picture and understanding. When Jesus is talking, what he is actually talking about and why it's so important, the things that he is going to say. Now, we can't just look at this in isolation either. We have to remember what Chris talked about last week in chapter 9, where it was the guy that was healed from being blind, right? He was blind from birth. He's healed. The Pharisees are debating whether or not it should have happened or was it right and this and the other. Why? Because it's the Sabbath again. They seem to have a real hang up on that. And they miss the miracle that Jesus did yet again. And as a result of everything, the guy ends up getting kicked out of the temple because he said that obviously Jesus is obviously someone of importance and the Pharisees disagree. Now, here's the sad thing. Those Pharisees should have been the shepherds of Israel at the time. They should have been the ones leading the people of Israel to God on a daily basis. And instead, they had gotten consumed by their own self-righteousness. They had gotten consumed with their religious rituals, that they thought that the rituals were more important than guiding people to Christ as they were supposed to be. And when Christ is standing right in front of them, they want to argue about what day he healed a man from blindness. Let's hope that we don't get that way. Let's hope that we don't get so hung up on our preferences that we forget the matter of Jesus being at the center point. He is the reason for everything. So let's look at the beginning of chapter 10, where it says this. Very truly I tell you, Pharisees, anyone who does not enter the sheep pen by the gate, but climbs in by some other way is a thief and a robber. The one who enters by the gate is the shepherd of the sheep. The gatekeeper opens the gate for him, and the sheep listen to his voice. He calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. And when he has brought out all his own, he goes ahead of them, and his sheep follow him because they know his voice. But they will never follow a stranger. In fact, they will run away from him because they do not recognize a stranger's voice. Jesus used this figure of speech, but the Pharisees did not understand what he was telling them. Therefore, Jesus said again, "Very truly I tell you, I am the gate for the sheep. All who have come before me are thieves and robbers, but the sheep have not listened to them. I am the gate. Whoever enters through me will be saved." Now here we see that Jesus has a special relationship with his sheep. It says these words of a loving shepherd show what the relationship should be like. He calls them by name. He knows them personally. He guides them out. It's not enough to simply be Jesus' sheep and stay in the sheep pen. No, we are to follow where he leads. Now imagine this. Picturing back to that sheepfold that we have, you have multiple flocks in this sheepfold, right? And one of the shepherds comes up and just starts calling out names. And all the sheep don't start moving. One sheep starts moving. And as the next name is called, the next one comes out. Because the relationship that shepherds have with their flock is the flocks know their voice. Now, why is that so important? Because guess what? If we call ourselves Christians or someone who follows Christ, the only way for us to know his voice is to be in his word. If we're not in his word, we're not going to know his voice. That's how you have some people say, "Well, I feel like God is leading me to do this." And it's completely contrary to what the Bible says. That's not his voice. That's us interjecting our own desires to do something opposite of what the Bible says. Where the Bible is supposed to be the authority, the Bible is the voice, is the word, Jesus himself. The only way we can follow his voice and know his voice as a sheep is by being in the word, knowing what the word says. My words don't mean much. But when you look at the word of God, that is what has power. That has power to change lives. We've seen people give their testimonies at different times what God is doing in their life. Why? Because of God's word. Not because of anything that's any person who stood up here and preached something. No, it's God's word that has the power. God's word that means the most. Notice back in verse 4 where it said, "When he has brought out all his own, he goes ahead of them. And his sheep follow him because they know his voice." Why is it so important for the shepherd to lead? Because understand this, it's not enough just to be in the sheepfold. If the sheep were determined to stay in that sheepfold because they felt safe there, they were comfortable there, they had their favorite part of the sheepfold where there was a little bit more hay and they could lay on it or something, what's going to eventually happen? They're going to die in there. Why? Not because of something attacking, but because they refuse to follow the shepherd. Why? Because the shepherd is the one that leads to pasture. The shepherd is the one that leads them to the best places to graze and to eat. He leads them to water. And in Jesus' case, he leads them to life. Because it's through him. He declares this. But why does Jesus do this? Because he's making a couple statements in here that he wants people to understand completely what it is that he is declaring. There's two times in here that he makes what's called I am statements. And why is that so important? Because understand this, when we go back to the Old Testament and you have Moses there, God is talking to Moses. He says, well, who do I tell Pharaoh is commanding me? He says, you tell him I am. That is a declaration of God saying who he is. I am is this statement of deity. It is this statement that this is God speaking. And so when Jesus says, "Very truly I tell you, I am the gate for the sheep," All who come before me are thieves and robbers, but the sheep have not listened to me. I am the gate. Whoever enters through me will be saved. Notice he doesn't say whoever comes through whichever gate they feel like will be saved. What he's declaring it, he is the only way. He says this again in John 14:6, where he says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one can come to the Father except through me. So the world will sit there and say, well, you know, all these different religions, all these different gods, all these different things, they all lead to the same place. No, they don't. You realize that in following Christ is the only one that we can have the assurance of eternity? Every other religion that you look at, every other thing that you look at, it's like, I'm going to work my hardest, try my hardest to earn God's favor, and hopefully at the end, the scales will tip in my direction. That doesn't sound too comforting, does it? But yet when you look at here, it says, I am the gate. Whoever enters through me will be saved. It doesn't say might be saved. It doesn't say hope to be saved. It says will be saved. Because he is the gate. It's only through him that we can have an eternal life and an eternal relationship with God the Father. That is what he is declaring here. Jesus is the gate to salvation. Jesus is the gate, not only salvation, but he is the gate to real freedom. Going and coming. As he leads out from the sheepfold, we're to follow him. And when he brings us back to the sheepfold at night, we are to rest in him. But the whole thing is following him. He's the focal point. He is the center. And then when we follow him, those green pastures are there. The living water that he talked about when we talked about the Samaritan woman. The living water, he is there. Everything I need can be found in Jesus. He is the gate to the best life possible and eternal life. And notice, if you look in your Bibles there on the second part of verse 10, it says, I have come that they may have life and have it to the full. He doesn't want to just give you an okay life. He wants to give you the best life possible. But see, at the same time, in contrast, we have Satan who tries to climb over the walls of our life. And he is described as a thief who is always trying to, at the beginning of verse 10, steal, kill, and destroy. Who do you want to follow there? The one who wants to steal, kill, and destroy, or the one who says, no, I want you to have life to the full? And unfortunately, he presents himself as one offering a better life, a life of freedom and self-determination. But remember, we are sheep. We were created to be interdependent, not independent. The world literally runs on this thing that Satan does of going, you just need that one more thing to feel complete and satisfied. It's funny, a couple years ago, we were meeting with the youth. And I said, guys, what's something that you were so excited and thought you wanted that when you got it, it was underwhelming and didn't really make you feel like, yeah, this is complete. One of the first one is one of our guys who loves gaming. And he looked at me, he goes, PS5. He's like, so pointless. And I was like, yeah, man. I said, that can be. And he was like, I thought it was going to make me just kind of get feel better again and everything else. And it was just after COVID. And he's like, pointless. And that was a big admission for him because he was really into gaming and everything else. But he's like, it's pointless. Satan is trying to convince us that he's the one that's going to give us the freedom. He's the one that's going to give us the way to be free from all the weight and cares and worries of this world. But if you ever notice, everything that people try to fill their lives with, eventually the effects wear off, don't they? And we're left feeling empty. We're left feeling like we need something else. But Jesus is sitting there saying, I have come that you may have life and have it to the full. Jesus continues next in verse 11. It says, I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. The hired hand is not the shepherd and does not own the sheep. So when he sees the wolf coming, he abandons the sheep and runs away. Then the wolf attacks the flocks and scatters it. The man runs away because he is a hired hand and he comes and he cares nothing for the sheep. I am the good shepherd. I know my sheep and my sheep know me. Just as the Father knows me and I know the Father, I lay down my life for the sheep. Now here we have the second I am statement. And he wants to leave no doubt as to what he means. Because as he declares this, he says, notice there at the top, it says, I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. He is flat out saying, I am willing to lay down my life for each and every one of my sheep, my flock. Whereas Satan, on the other hand, he sits there and tries to get you to come out. And as soon as he's out there, what does he do? He goes, I can't believe you did that. Jesus says, follow me. And if attackers come, I will lay my life down for you. Not only is salvation only possible through him as the gate, but he then guides and walks with us through this relationship. Willing not only to live for his sheep, but also willing to lay his life down. Now think about that. How many people in your life would you lay your life down for? Because that's the real measure of how much we love somebody and care for somebody and stuff like that, right? And Jesus says, every one of my flock is willing, I'm willing to lay my life down for them. You ever thought about this? When we, around Easter time and Good Friday, when we sit there and read through what leads up to the cross, he died for the guys who were whipping him. He died for the guys who were nailing him to the cross. He laid his life down for everyone. We just have to come and accept. Let me ask you a question. I don't know about you guys. I love films. Drives Sarah crazy, I think. We're at the point now where she's like, go see the film. I'll be at home. And I'm like, yes. Okay. I have yet to see a film where the villain or where the hero lays his life down for the villain. And I've never seen a villain die for the hero. And yet Jesus goes, I'm willing to die for everybody. Why? Because that is why he came. And we know this because here in verse 16 he says, I have other sheep that are not of this sheep pen, and I must bring them also. They too will listen to my voice, and there shall be one flock and one shepherd. The reason my Father loves me is that I laid down my life only to take it up again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down on my own accord. I have authority to lay it down and authority to take it up again. This command I received from my Father. So there's a purpose. There's a reason the whole way through. He says, I have the authority not only to lay my life down, but I have authority to take it up again. But here he's also wanting people to understand it's not just about them. Now he has a Jewish audience there as the children of Israel. He's sitting there talking to them, but he's wanting them to understand and show them that the plan from the start, once again, that has been reiterated from Genesis all the way to Revelation, is that he came for all nations, all tribes, all tongues, all cultures and backgrounds. And that's why he says, I have other sheep that are not of this pen. Basically he's saying, I have Gentiles that are also my sheep too. And if they were, understand, when he says this is a big thing. Because he's declaring this to a group that thinks that Gentiles are worthless, that they are less than scum and everything else. And he's going, no. I've come for everyone. It doesn't matter their background. It doesn't matter the culture they come from. It doesn't matter what language they consider their heart language. I have come for them all. And they'll be one flock under one shepherd. And students say, well, what does that look like? Look around. I love the fact that when we look around our church, we have so many backgrounds, so many cultures, so many different things. Because God goes, this is how it's supposed to be. This is the point. God shows this time and time again. And here Jesus asserts his power and the mission he is on to not only lay his life down, but take it back up again. See, we look at different things, and when we look at Jesus, he's the only one that says, I will lay my life down and I will take it up again. He's going to say, well, how do we know that was true? How do we know that actually happened? Well, if you look at the change in the disciples, you look at the change in their life before the crucifixion and after the crucifixion, the boldness that comes out of them after the crucifixion is immense. The guys who would run, swear, and everything else to get people to not think they were with Jesus before are now going to the same council who sends them to death and go, which one do you think it's better, to obey God or obey you? We'll keep going with God. Not only that, but it says that he showed himself to over 500 people at one time. When was the last time you saw 500 people agree on anything? Yet then they were willing to lay their life down for what they saw. Because Jesus did exactly what he said. He kept his word. He laid his life down and he took it up again. The reason he does all this, you look at sin and death cannot surround his sheep or threaten his sheep because he's already defeated it completely. So, if we look at sin and death, if we are part of his flock, we don't have to worry about it. Because he was sufficient to take care of it all. Why? Because he's our good shepherd. He's conquered all the threats that can ever confront us. Sometimes when we think of salvation and stuff like that, we get really focused on us and our testimony and what's happened with us and everything else. But let me just say this. Salvation is not a testimony about us. It's a testimony about him and who he is. Now, he is a good shepherd. Now, he is the gate that we can only come to know God through him. It's only through him that we can have the fullest life possible. And some people sit there and say, well, then I miss out on this in life and this in life and this in life. I want you to tell me if there's real satisfaction with those things that people are trying to convince. Because if there was real satisfaction, the world would be the happiest place ever. But yet we look at the struggles that the world has. It seems like no one can fill the voids. Why? Because only Jesus can fill that void in us. Does that mean we won't have pain? No, we will have pain, but we also have a good shepherd who will be walking with us through it. And the great thing is this, not only is he going to walk us through it, he gives us others to walk through it with because we're part of a flock. And when we're part of a flock, that means God gives us people around us to help lift us up in times where we are struggling, when we're hurting, when we're going through things that we think no one else can understand. And all of a sudden we find somebody in the church family that has been through a situation similar. And if they haven't, they're willing to sit there and weep with those who weep, cry with those who are crying, laugh with those who are laughing. Because God's plan is perfect. So what should we be doing then? Well, the most basic answer is we have to make a choice on him. See, saying, well, I'm not going to make a choice about Jesus is making a choice. Because either we follow him or we don't. We accept his claims or we don't. And if we do, then that begins a relationship. We can follow him out of the sheepfold to the green pastures, to the living water. We can follow him when he says, look, this is the best way to do it. And you sit there and say, well, society says this. Yes, society says that. It doesn't change what the Bible is. I've seen some people in my life that where I've seen them go wrong is very simple. They let society dictate what Scripture is saying instead of Scripture dictating what Scripture is saying. Society hasn't really changed that much. We may sit there and go, oh, what? But if you go back and you study things like Roman culture and Greek culture and stuff like that, there's nothing new under the sun. It's just the access to the information that we have. So are we going to let Jesus guide us and direct us and follow him? Are we going to accept him and become part of that flock? Or are we going to stay in the sheep pen with everybody else that goes, no, I like this pen. I'm going to stay here. The world's pretty good. That's a scary thought. So my prayer is this today. Maybe you've come to know Christ as your Savior, but you're struggling right now. God gives us a church family to walk with. Come and talk to one of us leaders. Talk to Jeff or Austin or myself. Ladies, if you want to talk to Sarah or Toyin or Helena or Syl, and allow us to walk through situations that you're in together. If you have questions about who Christ is and making a decision about following Christ and accepting him as your Savior, please talk to one of us. But don't put it off any longer, because none of us are guaranteed tomorrow. Let's pray. Lord, we just thank you, Lord, that Jesus declares that he is the gate, that he is the good shepherd. Lord, that he points out to the Pharisees and those who were standing there, and he points out to us now, Lord, that he is the only way to be saved. And not only be saved, but he is the way to have the best life possible, life to the full. The effects don't wear off, Lord, because as we walk in a relationship with you, Lord, you are the one that sustains us. You are the one that guides us. There will be hard times, Lord, we can hold on to you and know that you are with us and you will never leave us or forsake us. Lord, I just pray, Lord, for everyone here. Lord, I know there's a lot of different circumstances and a lot of different battles and things happening right now, Lord, but you are faithful. You are true. And Lord, we just pray that you would lift us up, that we would see your face in every area of life. Lord, we pray for those who are hurting. We pray that we could be a comfort to them. Lord, use us to point people towards you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.
Thank you, Ryan, for those wonderful, encouraging words. I will take our final song, which is Psalm 23.
For your endless mercy.
You got the 2 o'clock in the afternoon for if you're running maybe working shift and you're not available in the evening. There's a 2 o'clock meeting at Margot's place, and there's an in-person one at 8 o'clock at 8 p.m. at Elena and Chris's place, just up in Plumstead Pier. And perhaps you're not able to go to any of these physical ones. There's an online possibility as well at 8 p.m. You know, that just need to log in on your phone or your computer, your iPad. And if you don't want to show your face, you're allowed not to show your face. And if you want to, we gladly want to see your face as well. Somebody's laughing. They know themselves, they don't show their faces. But it's okay. God knows you. And we've been announcing this for a few weeks now, the church weekend away, which is between 10th and 12th of May. I don't know what the latest count is.
It's still under 50.
Still under 50. I think it's close to 50. 50 is not the maximum. That's the minimum we need to get to. But understand there's space for up to 70, 75 people. So perhaps you are still yet to decide, do I want a girl, do I want a girl? Just take one of your holidays and just book the thing, please. It's going to be fun together, honestly. Just going to be weekend that way. It's not loaded at all. It's a lot of relaxing time. And I can see, I've seen the names of those who are like, Kay is even coming. You know, so she's going to be, and if you want to have a good chat, just engage Kay. She's lovely. She's loved and encouraged. Honestly. I enjoy every time I spend with her, every time I go to her house, and she can pamper you too. Anyway. You just need to register. She's blushing now. You just need to register, and we just need £25 deposit, you know, ASAP for that. And in case you want to put £25 in cash, you can put it in the offering bowl, offering box at the back. Just write on it, weekend away. And if you want to do it online, there are slips at the back that shows the church bank account details as well. And if you want to give to the church, that's also an opportunity to do that. Thank you so much for everyone. And I pray that as we go this week, you're going to have a beautiful, lovely week as we trust in God alone. Thank you so much. God bless you.